Okay, so let's get started. My name is Geralyn Trujillo. I'm an attorney at the Federal Trade Commission. I'm very happy to not be furloughed at the moment after the shutdown this week. So the first thing I want to do is thank the organizers, Danny, Harry, and Ned, especially Danny, for organizing the conference and inviting me to participate. So the papers in this session cover a wide range of issues on antitrust and institutional issues. And let me first introduce the presenters. So we're going to have George Contreras, who is from the University of Utah, who will discuss holdup in the world of intellectual property and standard setting. We'll have Marco Claudio Corradi and Julian Nowag from Lund University, who will discuss the intersection of corporate opportunity rules and antitrust law. And then Rory Van Loo of Boston University School of Law, who will discuss the potential role of consumer law in mitigating inequality. And then next, we'll have John Newman from the University of Memphis School of Law, who will advocate for the market failure approach in analyzing pro-competitive justifications under the rule of reason. We have a star-studded cast of academic discussants. We have Michael Carrier of Rutgers University School of Law, Scott Hemphill of NYU School of Law, who was my former boss at the New York State Attorney General's office as the Antitrust Bureau Chief, Danny Sokol from the University of Florida, and another former Antitrust Bureau Chief, Harry First of NYU. And aside from myself, we have two practitioner discussants who have both had very distinguished careers and are stars in their own right. Helene Jaffe, who is the co-chair of Fox Rothschild's Antitrust Practice Group, and John Jacobson, who is a partner at Wilson Sonsini and the chair of the ABA's Antitrust Section of Law. So before we begin with the papers, we're going to do things a little bit differently in our session. Because we have such a wide range of topics, we're going to take each paper one at a time, with the practitioners discussant comments coming directly after the academic discussants comments, and then we'll have audience questions at the end, other than for Jorge's paper, George's paper, because he has to leave at noon. We'll do all of the comments for his paper from the audience right off the bat. Okay, so George?
Go and I guess okay. And unlike the last session, there's not a person here to tee up our slides.
It's just at the bottom.
Here we go. Ah, there is. Thanks. Sorry. All right. Great. Thank you. Thank you very much. And thank you for accommodating my schedule issue at noon. I have to go join a call on an advisory council at the National Institutes of Health where I'm needed to form a quorum. So a very important role that I will play on that call. But I'm here today to talk about a debate that's been going on for at least 15 years in the field, being the intersection of antitrust and patent law relating to standards essential patents. This is something of a response to a number of papers that have come out in the last few years about this topic. And this audience, I think, is probably pretty familiar with the basic setup. Competitors get together to develop technical standards for product interoperability. We allow them to do this in an exchange. Standards organizations require that that patents covering those standards that were collaboratively developed have to be licensed to implementers of the standard, that's product manufacturers, either on fair, reasonable, and non-discriminatory terms or royalty-free terms. Obviously, the most contentious area here is the FRAND licensing. There are many disagreements over what FRAND means, what level of royalties are fair and reasonable, and there's been a significant amount of litigation in that area. The term holdup is used to describe a situation, it's been used in the literature now for about 20 years, where a higher than FRAND royalty could be charged, often with the threat of an injunction backing up the negotiation after a standard is adopted, resulting in the patent holder's ability to appropriate royalties or rent in excess of the value of its contributed technology, and which is up to the level of the manufacturer's switching costs, right, which are quite high once standards become broadly adopted in the industry. The holdup terminology was borrowed from Oliver Williamson's work on transaction cost economics, and Williamson's model of opportunism with guile, which is how he defined holdup, is really not what we're talking about here. Guile or dishonesty is not necessarily required with this form of holdup. However, we have something of a conflation of terminology that, if nothing else, has clouded the debate even more. So what we have at issue today is there is certainly litigation evidence of royalties being charged that are higher than what courts have determined FRAND royalty rates to be in a number of U.S. cases. You know, we have orders of magnitude difference between the initial royalty demands sought by holders of standard essential patents and what courts have determined the fair and reasonable rates to be based on a variety of factors. Again, you know, Microsoft and Motorola, one of the first of these cases, finding about a 2,000 times difference in these rates, and similarly large discrepancies have been found in many subsequent cases, both in the U.S. and in other jurisdictions. The objection to this type of evidence of holdup is that this is anecdotal, case by case, although today we are seeing a significant enough accumulation of cases that I think this objection to the question, is there holdup, has less force, right? But the question that is being debated right now is there holdup? And there is a strong line of papers out there that says, well, there's really not, because we have no empirical evidence that holdup exists. Neither positive evidence that holdup is occurring on a systemic market-wide level, in addition to that, we have significant direct negative evidence that the market in cellular telecommunications product is doing really well, right? We have significantly increased functionality at not extremely high and affordable prices, and year after year, the technology has improved. The prices have remained relatively stable on a time basis. So even if there were holdup, it's not a real problem in the industry, or it doesn't exist at all, right? These are the what I call the empirical challenges to the holdup theory. So holdup, you know, everybody acknowledges it is a theoretical possibility, but there is a significant challenge on the empirical side as to whether it exists. And this is important for policymaking, right? This argument is used in policymaking, the extent that if there's no evidence of holdup, policy decisions should not be made on the basis that holdup is a problem. All right, so there are a number of things to say about this argument and to counter the empirical argument. And the first is that it's actually difficult to detect holdup. And this is not an accident, right? The license agreements that are negotiated between parties that have these royalty rates are confidential. You don't get to see them. The only time that these rates are visible is generally in the litigation context when they're produced in discovery. And even then, they're often under protective order. We also have confounding evidence from cross licenses and so forth. All of this makes actual cases of holdup outside of litigated cases quite difficult to detect. Another confounding factor is that there has been a significant amount of activity, both from regulatory agencies and in litigation, that may discourage holdup behavior, right? So this may explain why holdup is not as prevalent or rampant as you might expect it to be, just given normal market forces, because there already has been a deterrent effect from existing regulation. Okay. As far as the positive market indicator story, that the market is doing great, profitability is high, prices are low, functionality is high, this is, in my view, a false argument, right? It's a fallacious argument. And one way that we can sort of test whether positive market indicators tell the story and describe whether or not there is a problem, particularly an antitrust problem, is by looking back at the late 19th century and thinking about what were market conditions when the Sherman Act was being considered and adopted, when I think most people in this room would agree that there was significant cartel activity, significant anti-competitive activity going on in a number of markets in the United States. Decreasing output is one of the signs that you would look for in markets that were hobbled by these sorts of anti-competitive practices. But if you look at the actual output during the late 19th century of some of these commodities, which were the targets of antitrust enforcement, output was doing fine, right? In salt, petroleum, steel, coal, these are classic industries in which collusion was occurring in those days. Prices, consumer prices, you would expect consumer prices to rise in a market that was suffering from serious antitrust problems. And again, you know, again, I didn't gather this data. This is all from a 1985 paper that collected the 19th century data from Census and Statistical Abstracts of the United States. Prices were falling also in many of these industries. So what does that mean? Was the Sherman Act unnecessary because positive market indicators existed? You know, of course not, or at least I think most people would agree the Sherman Act was not unnecessary. You have, some of you may disagree, but. The point that I'm making, though, with these examples is that anti-competitive conduct can occur and does occur even when markets by some indices seem to be doing well. There can be reductions in competition, certainly barriers to entry by smaller players. Innovation can be reduced as something extremely difficult to measure. And of course, the counterfactual is unknown in these situations, particularly in the wireless telecommunications market. We don't know what a smartphone would cost absent absent these factors. Today, a new iPhone costs $1,000. A new laptop, I literally just bought one yesterday here in New York because my old one broke. It costs about $2,000. You know, it's possible that these things could cost less. This is actually quite expensive in some parts of the world, right? So we do not know what the counterfactual would be, and we don't know how much additional technology or innovation could be embodied in one. So the question I have is, why do we care about systemic holdup? Why should we be looking at this at all? And it's sort of like an analogy to the public health situation, right? So we can propose, look, we should take public health measures to prevent spread of Ebola virus, right? Okay, but here's the empirical argument against it. If Ebola were a problem in the US, we would see outbreaks of Ebola. We have not found any outbreaks of Ebola in the United States. Therefore, there's no empirical evidence that Ebola is a systemic problem in the United States, and there's no justification for public health measures against Ebola, right? This is obviously a ludicrous argument because it is the prevention of the undesired effect that both public health and the antitrust authorities seek to achieve. Oops, there's that person. Okay, so conclusion. How should we deal with this? We certainly do have laws and enforcement that deals with actual anti-competitive and abusive conduct. And this is an individual company-by-company phenomenon. We do not need to find market-wide indicators that this is a problem in order to enforce and create policies to prevent this type of behavior, right? Just because there's not a murder wave in New York doesn't mean that murder is okay or that it is not something that we should have laws to prevent or that we should not enforce vigorously against. So I would say to the scholars and others who have tried to dissuade policy action on the basis of a lack of systemic evidence of holdup that this is not really a valid approach to what is a real potential problem. Thank you.
Thank you. Michael? Sure.
It is a pleasure to respond to George, who is a leading scholar on standard setting. In fact, if there was a market for articles written on standard setting, George would be the monopolist. And it's fine, George is such a nice guy, he would not hold us up. Nonetheless, it really is important what George has to say about this. And as it turns out, George is absolutely right. There is too much obsession with the issue of holdup. The debates that go back and forth are very robust, they take up a ton of time, and at the end of the day, they encourage policymakers not to do anything. I think George is right. for all the reasons he mentions. He mentions five, and I think those are right. I think the counterfactual one is incredibly important. Just because you happen to see innovation going on right now doesn't mean that there can't be a problem. Maybe there could be more innovation absent the anti-competitive conduct. We don't see that in the studies that say, oh, telecom has lots of new products, therefore there can't be holdup. In addition to those five, maybe not rising to that level, there are a couple of others. And so in the ABA transition report for the president, we mentioned a couple of others. One was that over time, things changed. So maybe at the time of a study, there were very few patents. And then after that period, the number of patents went up, which increases the bottleneck effect. Also, we don't know every time a patent is not used or the follow-on invention effects that result from a patent or an excessive royalty. And so those are other points as well. But at the end of the day, I think George is right, and for all of these reasons, there's too much focus on holdup. And so stepping back, one question is, why is there so much obsession on holdup? So I don't know the answer, but let me offer a hypothesis. My hypothesis is that there is so much focus on holdup because there's concern with the underlying areas of law. Some folks have concern with the application of patent law or antitrust law or contract law, and they take those concerns and they project it onto holdup and say that, well, holdup is the problem here, when they're worried about all the things that are going on underneath. And there are a lot of really tricky issues here. So start with Frand. What does reasonable mean? That's very difficult. What does non-discriminatory mean? Also a tough question. What is the appropriate royalty base? Is it the overall product? Is the end component? Do we do a top-down approach or a bottom-up approach? One takes the overall price, figures out the percentage of patents. One looks at reasonable alternatives on the markets. Do we try to figure out the rate by looking at all of the 15 Georgia-Pacific factors or some of the Georgia-Pacific factors? Do we look at a comparable license, the importance of the patent, the importance of the standard? Do we focus on difficult issues like reciprocity or tying arbitration or obligations on transfer? All of this is for the Frand term itself, which is packed with complexities and ambiguities. Then you turn to contract law. What's standing to enforce? Who's a third-party beneficiary? We look at antitrust law. Is it an antitrust violation for a party who's made a Frand promise to then get an injunction? Well, maybe it depends on whether there's a willing licensee. What's a willing licensee? There are a couple of egregious cases, but usually it's not clear. And the parties fight over whether or not there really is a willing licensee. More complicated issues. In terms of global comity, sometimes like the Microsoft Motorola case, you have one court issuing a decision on an injunction that could affect products in another country. What do we do with that? And finally, patents. There are some folks, including the head of the antitrust division, that think that antitrust should have no role at all to play in dealing with holdup, that a patent means a right to exclude, and you cannot intrude on that right whatsoever. So at the end of the day, I think that a lot of the concern with holdup is based on concerns with the underlying issues and the underlying areas of law. I don't know what we can do about that because by their nature, these are complicated issues. It's not like we can offer a magic formula that would tell us what Frand is, but that might be one of the reasons that is motivating a lot of this unease. Finally, a few small suggestions that George could add to his otherwise excellent paper. I'd love to see an example of where there is no general holdup, but still could be a specific problem. So for example, in the Ericsson case and in the ITC's interdigital case, the judges said there's no holdup problem, so therefore there's nothing to worry about. Might there still be an individual concern, anti-competitive conduct that doesn't manifest itself in holdup? And so that's not something that we might find in the court decisions, but maybe if you look at the plaintiff's pleadings, we'll get evidence that there is something that's concerning, because I think that's one place where we can see that even if there's not holdup, there still could be reason for concern. In addition, I love the focus on comparisons and analogies. It might be presumptuous for me to ask for more when George is already talking about Ebola, murder, look at his paper, he has burglary, he has the 1880s, how dare I ask for more? Nonetheless, something has to stick, something has to get through to those, and maybe they have every incentive not to change, but some of these analogies might work, because I think holdup really is a unique situation. In what other area of law do we say, hey, plaintiff, we don't even want to hear from you until you can show that there's a general problem in the industry? I don't think that happens in other areas of IP and antitrust law. In pharmaceutical antitrust, it's not like we say to the plaintiff, hey, you want to show that a settlement is bad, you have to show that all settlements are bad, or that if there's a product hopping case, you have to show that all reformulations are bad. And I don't think a plaintiff could show that. I think that the FTC annual reports show that the vast majority of settlements are not concerning because they don't involve payment. I think the vast majority of reformulations that brand companies engage in are fine because they're not keyed to generic entry. And so if a plaintiff had to prove in each of these cases a general problem, they never would. And so there's something to be said for figuring out why holdup is so unique. And then finally, my last point deals with just what we do as scholars. And so let's just assume for the sake of argument that George is absolutely right. How then can this argument make its way to the places that matter? And I think that, I mean, George has done this as much as anyone, getting his arguments out into the public sphere. But ways of doing it even more could be amicus briefs in some of these cases, making clear to courts that it doesn't always matter if there's holdup as a general matter. Perhaps letters to the agencies, time is right, the Department of Justice, head of the antitrust division just said that there's no holdup and that patentees can't be limited at all. And there's one letter that I recently signed on to that took issue with that letter, but there are other points that George could raise that I think would be very important. And so just concluding, it's worth thinking about how we take these really important and influential ideas and get them outside the realm of academia so those who could act on them do act on them. And so finally, thank you, George, for writing such a good paper.
Thank you.
Okay, so I'll just offer a few comments. We divided up the papers between me and Helene. So George, I thought it was an excellent paper, and I really don't have an issue with the main premise that, you know, trying to look for systemic holdup is really a fruitful exercise. And so I congratulate you on that premise. I just have some suggestions for the paper itself, which I really enjoyed. The first thing is in part one, since you're talking about the issue and you want to present it to the uninitiated, it would be very helpful to explain why holdup occurs in the first place. In other words, in the real world, in the standard setting process, there is some lack of contracting that goes on that causes holdup. So why do members of a standard setting organization agree to use a certain standard without first negotiating the terms of a license? I mean, you know, in an ideal world, maybe that would occur to prevent the disputes, but it might be completely unwieldy for a standard setting organization to really do that. And to organize the numerous patents that are involved in a standard. And are they only, is the standard setting organization only really focused on the engineering solutions and not really focused on defining FRAND and the licensing terms? And then I think you could say a little bit more about what standard setting organizations are actually doing to try to define FRAND, if that's possible, or any kind of measures that they've adopted, such as the members of the standard setting organization have to disclose all their patents so that there's no surprise once the standard is selected that, you know, someone is going to assert that they have the standard and they're going to assert that patent once the standard is selected. So I think that would be just very interesting from a real world point of view. And then my second comment is just you talk about the differences in definitions of holdup in your paper. There's a section where you state, you know, various definitions that have appeared in the case law, and you say that this has led to severe consequences. I would love to have just an explanation of what those consequences were. I just think that maybe, you know, if this paper is in more of a draft form and maybe you haven't developed that, but I would love to really know what those consequences were based on the great gradations of definitions of holdup. And I think that was pretty much it. You know, it would be nice when you're talking about in the section about the evidence of lack of evidence, where you have your terrific Ebola virus analogy, which I thought was terrific. You know, you really address some empirical evidence that shows that, you know, in these tech industries, there's higher profits and higher innovation, and so there must not be systemic holdup and must not be occurring. You know, what is the argument that patent holdup is systemic across the market? Is there such an argument, and are there critiques of that argument? It just might balance out the discussion in that section. So, but very well done. Very interesting paper. And John, who is our overall discussant, I don't know if you have any thoughts.
I have a few brief ones. First, a disclaimer. The ABA will disavow everything I say. My clients who are on the defense side of these cases will disavow everything I have to say. And my clients who are on the plaintiff side of these cases will certainly disavow everything I have to say. So having said this, this is a great area because over the years, and I've been practicing a long time, we've seen the topics of potential antitrust violations narrow, and narrow further still. Intra-brand restraints are basically gone. And a whole slew of conduct that was previously viewed as questionable is no longer. So one of the few really new areas is holdup, and particularly with regard to standards essential patent. And as an antitrust practitioner over a long period of time, it is refreshing to see new areas finally being brought to bear. I do take issue with the concept that the empirical data about the frequency of holdup doesn't matter. I think it does matter for the simple reason that if it never happened or happened, you know, once in a purple moon, we would have a rule of per se legality. Our per se rule is premised on the administrative efficiency of if it almost never happens. Like price fixing being good, you know, then we're going to ignore those instances and have a blanket rule so you don't have to worry about the details of every case. And I completely agree, and I think the paper is excellent, pointing out that getting empirical data in this area is extremely difficult. But there's one signpost that I think we should not ignore. These are very difficult because the law is unclear, and very expensive because the technology is difficult to understand, and the patent relationship and the ability to have competing patents that perform the same functions in a standards context, that these are situations where if someone is bringing a lawsuit, then they feel pretty aggrieved because it's going to cost them a lot of money. It's potentially going to take them a long time. So the fact that we're seeing a number of these cases out there at least is some sort of signal that this is a problem. And we are seeing, you know, a decent amount of cases of this sort brought. There are only a few that make headlines, but there are a lot out there that are settled reasonably quickly, and the ones that are brought, you know, involve that get into the public domain involve very important technology, you know, for cellular phones and other devices. So I think the paper could be improved by addressing that sort of signal of frequency. And then having nothing to do with the subject, but you brought out 1890. So 1890 in the Sherman Act, in my reading, you know, the antitrust paradox notwithstanding, had almost nothing to do with output. It had to do with, you know, in a large part of the world, the reaction to the Industrial Revolution was communism. In other areas of the world, it was socialism. And the U.S. response was the Sherman Act, which was to have the free market govern the terms of trade. And that's, you know, much more than output was what, at least from my reading, what 1890 was all about. But a super paper, great topic. Keep up the good work.
Okay, I want to make, I didn't make my usual disclaimer, which I want to make as a federal government employee, which is the views I'm expressing today are entirely my own and do not reflect or represent the views of the commission or any of the commissioners. I just forgot to say that, and in case anybody's going to report back to my boss, I wanted to make that statement. So I just wanted to, since George has to leave us, does anybody have questions in the audience or any comments on this topic before we move on to the second paper?
Yes, sir.
Hey, George. Hey. As you know, one of the pushback arguments already mentioned was why is this just a contracting problem? But the other is, isn't the real problem pulled out, not pulled up? And haven't seen a press or empirical evidence of pulled out, just an assumption that that's the problem. So maybe in approaching that argument, you can look at it symmetrical way and really point out that we don't know either way. And use that argument against those who say, oh, it's a problem that somehow antitrust should ignore because it's pulled out. Maybe we should not ignore it because either is a concern. And the second brief point is if you were looking for anti-competitive conduct today, and let's just take something concrete, HSR filing. There are very few mergers that we deem to be anti-competitive. And most joint ventures go without any question. And exclusionary conduct, if you were looking at it for some of the same reasons, it's not transparent. You wouldn't know what's going on. So a lot of those arguments would apply to everything that we have the Sherman Act and the Clayton Act for today. Those things are not common, and they are not transparent. That doesn't mean we don't have laws against them.
That's great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
Go for it. Yeah, I basically want to follow up on the point raised about costs and so on. And I was thinking about your Ebola example, and I haven't read the paper, so please excuse me. But I was thinking about the risk-cost relationship. That might be rather different here than the Ebola crisis. If we are all paying 1,000 instead of 100, maybe that's not as bad as two people in the room having Ebola here. Just a
fair
yes. Yes.
Okay, we're going to have, I think, our second paper. Okay, this is enforcing corporate opportunity rules.
No.
Okay, begin.
Okay. Well, first, many thanks for inviting Julian and me to this event. And this is a rather unusual topic. And I guess only Pat Chu in the 1990s tried to write something about this topic. So our thoughts are quite tentative. And we welcome many, many comments if possible, because I think we still need to work a lot on these papers. So I will just go quickly through the paper, giving you an idea of what corporate opportunity rules are, because I guess most of you are not corporate lawyers. And then I will try to explain what might be the competitive harm brought by the enforcement of corporate opportunities rules. And then finally, I will address antitrust failures when we try to apply antitrust or EU competition law rules to the situation we define in this paper. So first, corporate opportunities. Well, this is an extremely difficult subject in corporate law, one of the most difficult ones, according to many, many corporate lawyers. But these are just very primitive ideas. They are informational assets, which may consist of information over inputs, such as, for instance, an oil field, or technological information, or, for instance, information about the possibility to buy equity, which may end up in eventually controlling a corporation, for instance. And This information is not only valuable, but is usually also confidential. So those who usually have access to this information are so-called insiders of a corporation, directors, controlling shareholders, for instance. And they may be tempted to appropriate this information and exploit the opportunity for their own benefits. This is a form of tunneling which is extremely detrimental to financial markets because it would set counter incentives for investors to invest in a corporation which is actually victim of tunneling. And therefore, corporate law traditionally has tried to face this problem through setting fiduciary duties, and namely in this case, directors and controlling shareholders' duty of loyalty. A misappropriation of corporate opportunity may trigger different kinds of remedy. The first potential remedy, damages, as actual positive damages or loss of profits, are available both in common and civil law, whereas disgorgement of profits is a typical common law remedy. There might be residual cases of disgorgement under German law among the European sets, say, of corporate laws, but it's a very, very residual case. And what is interesting in common law is that when you have a disgorgement of profits, usually the remedy is assisted by a constructive trust, which is declared on the newly founded entity. This is a bare trust, which usually is followed by a transfer order, which means that the assets of the newly formed corporation as an ongoing concern are transferred to the incumbent corporation. So these rules are extremely important from a corporate law perspective. They are mandatory rules in every single EU corporate law system. However, in US law, there was a rather recent reform in US Delaware corporate law, which was followed actually by other US states reform, which allow a waiver for corporate opportunities use. And the rationale of this waiver is that venture capital funds usually appoint the same directors on newcos, which may be competitors. And these directors are physiologically in a position of divided loyalty. So there was a necessity to introduce this kind of possible waiver. And even if when the corporate opportunity doctrine is not waivable, there is a possibility of an ex-ante authorization for takings or ex post ratification for misappropriations. Well, if from a corporate law perspective these potential takers are to be considered as thieves, actually they may end up becoming the best competitors of a corporation, especially when they do acquire technical knowledge which they may be able to exploit outside the corporation. I'm borrowing a slide from a presentation I'm giving next week at the American Society of Comparative Law on director inventors. So I collected some, I did a small, say, empirical study on this subject. And actually, there are many former directors which might have, say, taken corporate opportunities and developed them through their new course. And what is interesting to see is, for instance, Martin Eberhardt, a former Tesla director, he founded a corporation which is a competitor of Tesla, but he waited for 2 years before setting up this corporation. So in the meantime, he did some consultancy. We don't know exactly whether he's using ideas he actually acquired while he was working for Tesla. Now, what are the potential, what is the potential competitive harm deriving from the enforcement of corporate opportunities rules, say, from not allowing an insider to take and develop this opportunity outside the corporation? From a static perspective, if we apply the theory of contestable markets, there shouldn't be many, many problems. Of course, these kind of rules say that you have a corporation which is active in the oil field and it acquires a new oil, an insider wants to acquire unfit for him or herself, and the company calls back the opportunity. Well, if there are, I don't know whether this is the best example, but say that there are not barriers to entry, well, in this case, of course, this kind of use favor the growth of a corporation, but if the corporation raises prices, there may be new entrants coming in the market and try to profit of the higher prices. So it may create some horizontal and vertical foreclosure, but this might be, say, residual cases. What puzzles us more are the cases in which there might be harm to dynamic competition. So when an invention is carried out through massive R&D investments, then maybe corporate opportunities use may have the same rationale of IP law. So they are not bad at all. But what about cases of disruptive innovation? And we know from Christensen's article that often disruptive innovation is not costly innovation. So what about these cases in which we don't need to protect that much our corporate investment in R&D? And say there's a director who invents a new technology. What are the potential reactions by the corporation? If the corporation has, the incumbent corporation has enough absorptive capacity, it may well be interested in integrating the invention within its own production line. However, if this new invention is a potential competitor and the corporation is not able to integrate the invention at the present time, it may decide to kill the invention, so not allow the insider to appropriate the opportunity, or it may want to delay the invention from being introduced on the market. So these are clearly like subtle damages, which can be caught only through dynamic analysis, but still rather concerning in principle. How might these cases be addressed through competition law? There's a very residual case. Say an insider appropriates a corporate opportunity and then the corporation decides not to go to court, but it signs a settlement agreement with the insider through which the newly formed corporation is merged to the incumbent corporation. But this kind of operation, say, is not caught by merger law because it falls under threshold. This might be caught by Article 101 of the Treaty on the Function of the European Union, or by conspiracy theory. The case, what about abuse of dominant position? Yeah, it might apply if the opportunity has been taken. At least in European law, we discussed it yesterday. We would need an abuser and an abused. So if the opportunity has not been taken because the corporation was able to stop the misappropriation before it happened, it would be difficult to apply reuse and abuse of dominant position. In any case, the application would be residual because you would need to show dominant position, which is not likely to happen all the time, or a significant market power of the incumbent corporation. What about merger law? Well, two cases. If the opportunity has not been appropriated, we don't have a newly founded entity, so merger law would not apply because there's only one incumbent corporation. A rather relevant case might be the one of an insider knowing about the possibility to buy equity and acquiring control over a given corporation, and then the incumbent corporation triggers the application of corporate opportunities doctrines, and the newly, the acquired corporation is then merged with the incumbent one. A second case might be the one of an insider which appropriates an inventive corporate opportunity. Well, these cases are unlikely to trigger the application of merger law, because usually a newly founded corporation has a very small turnover. So since thresholds are they are based on a company's turnover, then merger law may not apply again. So, as a matter of fact, we may have situations in which there is real harm to competition, but competition law and antitrust law perhaps are not fully able to tackle this kind of situation. There's like an interesting recent case, a Qualcomm case in Europe, like recently decided by the Commission, which shows some interest for attacking situation in which there was damage to dynamic competition. I don't know American law very much on this point, but I guess there is less interest towards this kind of situation. But still, I mean, it would be interesting to see how this kind of potential harm may be addressed in future, perhaps through the introduction of special rules or, well, okay. Many thanks.
Okay, Scott.
Great, so thanks for the opportunity to participate in this esteemed and extremely large group of presenters and commenters. And for the chance to talk about this paper. So this is a fascinating topic, one I hadn't thought about, and I think it presses its finger on a kind of deep and general problem, which I think is brought out in the paper and less just now in the presentation, which is, you know, what restrictions may a firm place on competition from its insiders. And I want to offer a comment about the facts presented in the paper about some of the underlying theory, and then finally about the implications. And to anticipate my bottom line, I have some skepticism about the application of, I'm probably not the only person that's going to offer some skepticism, about the implications that, you know, can we really do something using competition law in this space? And I think you guys are even a little bit maybe uncertain on that and are sort of exploring that at this stage. So first, with respect to facts, there aren't that many facts in this paper. One thing I would urge is more concrete detail. Right now, it's pretty structural, pretty abstract. The competitive harm is posited, but I think not fully established. I think you guys are missing a killer example, I think. And more generally, it's kind of crying out for more concrete examples. My favorite part, pulling out a place where I think you are doing some of this, what I'm urging, is when you talk about disruptive innovation by a former employee. You're playing around, as you said, with the Christensen disruptive innovator stuff, imagining in particular a kind of low-end product that the firm might not have the incentive to actually bring to light, so you can imagine the insider becoming an outsider and then doing that. I might spell that out more. This must have happened sometime. You play with that a little just now with the Tesla example. There might be more to do here. If you do find such a thing, then I would restructure around that, because I think you have some work still to kind of convince people that there's a there. And I think there might well be, whether or not we want to do something about it, there might well be, but there's just more to do to, I think, really, really build that up. The downside is, the more concrete it is, the more you give opponents a chance to kind of hook into it and say, gosh, if that's your example, then I feel even more strongly there shouldn't be any kind of liability here. Second, with respect to theory, so the paper presents both a kind of horizontal version and a vertical version. The horizontal story, I think, is pretty straightforward. You imagine the insider becoming an outsider and setting up, you know, their butcher shop to compete with the butcher shop that they were a director of, or the Tesla former director, I don't know, competing on batteries with Tesla, or, right? So the horizontal version of that, I think, is pretty easy. You guys play fairly briefly with the vertical version of that story, and I was having more trouble here. You were imagining an insider who sees a supplier opportunity. Maybe we could buy our supplier. I think you're imagining a vertical foreclosure kind of example where a dominant firm is buying its supplier or buying supply in order to exclude a rival. And I was having more trouble understanding why that, taking advantage of a corporate opportunity, how that would fit into an antitrust story. You might have imagined that purchase, I guess, thwarting the monopolization that was otherwise going to occur, but I was having trouble working that out. Why would this be the highest value? Why would the insider have the highest willingness to pay if the firm is otherwise going to engage in monopolization in this fashion? You would think that the firm itself would have the stronger incentive to make the purchase if there was an anti-competitive strategy implicated by the firm. So I would build out the vertical to look, either take out the vertical, because there's plenty of, you're covering a lot of ground as it is, and maybe the more straightforward horizontal story is enough to bite off, right? But if you do vertical, I would just sort of spell it out more strongly. And then with respect to implications, so as I said a minute ago, I think I have some skepticism about whether this is a promising place for liability. I think one way to get at this is to think about the analogies that exist between corporate opportunities and other doctrines that we think of more familiarly as being either inside of antitrust or at least sort of thought about vis-a-vis antitrust. You didn't really talk about non-competes just now in the presentation. Non-competes play a substantial role in the paper, and I think it's important to really do business with non-competes in order to kind of see where we are here. So that's one of several analogies I want to think about. I think the non-compete analogy tends to lead me away from wanting to assign liability here, kind of an a fortiori argument. So, you know, non-competes are post-employment. You know, allowing folks to compete with their firm, essentially, even though they are still insiders, reaches even deeper than non-competes, and I would think would be more disruptive if we were to allow sort of current directors or other fiduciaries to jump out and, ha-ha, surprise, start competing with their principal as an agent. Second, and related on non-competes, there's a question of the underlying incentives. Now, you guys emphasize, we just heard some discussion of holdup, you guys emphasize a version of holdup, and let's grant for a minute that with non-competes, the major issue is risk of holdup and negative incentives for investing in the worker, and that's one reason why we, you know, at least sometimes think non-competes are okay. But when we get to corporate opportunities doctrine, I think the issue is not just holdup, but just can the firm exist if their employees or their directors or other insiders are, you know, constantly at hazard from the standpoint of the firm, jump out and start competing with them. Like, that goes well beyond the, am I going to invest in training? Am I going to invest in, you know, relationship-specific capital? It's just a question of whether I can, in a basic way, delegate to agents if these agents are suddenly going to, again, sort of pop up. And I'm making this more whimsical than it is, but, you know, pop up and start competing with me. And then third, thinking about the non-compete analogy, you know, we have some public policy toward non-competes, and there's some great discussion in the paper, you know, relying on Saxanian and others about how the non-enforceability of non-competes can be pro-competition and pro-innovation, and there's lots of great reasons to think that that's part of the success of Silicon Valley in comparison with, you know, Route 128, but that merely goes as far as non-enforceability. And you guys are talking about, you know, maybe some, you know, more aggressive competition law. It made me wonder whether you need to go as far as that. I mean, you all might be content to say that taking advantage of a corporate opportunity, if it's been challenged, it's simply not enforceable, that you're just trying to nullify corporate opportunities doctrine. Now, I still think that it's a heavy lift, but it's less heavy than trying to assign antitrust liability or competition law liability. Another analogy you just might think about is, at least from a U.S. perspective, ancillary doctrine. So, you know, a lot of our horizontal agreement doctrine comes out of, you know, the old Addison Pipe case and related later cases that say, look, you know, if you sell a business to somebody, you might be tempted to turn around and compete with it using the goodwill that's built up. And maybe that's fine for you to do, but, you know, if the purchaser wises up beforehand and says, well, how about a contract that says you're not going to do that, right? I'm going to sell you the butcher shop, but then I can't go set up a butcher shop next to you if we have this contractual deal in mind, that's going to be enforceable. Even though we realize that ex post, right, if we nullified that contract, we'd see more competition, everything would fall apart in terms of the deals that get done ex ante unless we were able to make these sort of, you know, reasonable close-in contracts that are both ancillary to the deal being done and necessary to kind of make it happen, no broader than necessary. And so this felt to me pretty kind of similar to that you're going to allow these kind of short-range forces, these short-range contracts, because I think in some ways corporate opportunity is, although it's not maybe technically a contract, it has a kind of contractual feel that the employee, that the insider is going to restrain themselves in certain ways for the good of the firm, because otherwise the whole thing would fall apart. That ancillary has that feel too. So if you guys are right, then that it starts to make a lot of the agreements and relationships that we sort of take for granted start to dissolve. It starts to make ancillary not seem appropriate anymore, and that's an even bigger bite, you know, to take here. It's an even more ambitious position to take. And then finally, just one other analogy to think about. I wondered how to think about trade secrets here. You know, I can generally enforce an agreement with a supplier not to take my secret formula and then turn around and compete with me, even if doing so, right, would have some static benefit or even some dynamic benefit. You know, if your all's basic take here is right, does that also jeopardize how we think normally about, you know, trade secrets and the enforceability of contracts where a trade secret is implicated? So, all that said, super interesting area. I think you guys are making progress, but you know, across you know, concreteness of facts, thinking more about the vertical theory, even either amping it up or just getting rid of it, and then really trying to work through and fully do business with both the non-compete analogy and with the ancillary analogy, I think that would strengthen the project.
Helene?
Sure, I'm not, does this work?
Yep.
Okay. I basically agree with your conclusion that the antitrust laws aren't an effective way to address these corporate opportunity issues, but I agree because, one, in all my years of practice, I haven't seen it. So either it's not very prevalent or it's well disguised, or alternatively, to the extent the antitrust laws already apply, and we'll get to that in a moment, they're addressing these issues. So your premise, as I understand it, is that your best competitor to the incumbent corporation are the insiders, whether they're officers or directors, whatever. But that, by definition, means either that raises two sets or three sets of antitrust issues. Either the market, the relevant market, which you address later in your paper, is very, very narrow and that company is the only guy in town, or the only lady in town, it doesn't matter, but it's the monopolist. And that the only potential entrant to that business is somebody inside that corporation. That's a very, very narrow relevant market, a one company relevant market. It used to be one brand was tough enough as a relevant market, but in any event. So I think that's an issue. When you address that later in your paper, when you talk about whether you know, Section 2 or dominant company rules can apply here, and you say, well, the problem is you have to show market power. And I sit back as an antitruster and I say, yeah, because otherwise why are the antitrust laws implicated here? So that's one set. The second, and then when you keep talking about the insiders as being your actual or best potential competitors, then I come away thinking, well, and I guess recently when Twitter and Facebook CEOs walk off of Disney's board, we begin to see the Section 8 issue of sitting here having insiders who are your actual competitors. That's a Section 8 issue, assuming you get through, you know, the niceties of all of the that stuff. But conceptually, and if it's not a Section 8 issue, you start having Section 1 concerns on some level about having competitors or potential competitors. And as I said, I think the Disney example, in light of some other Section 8 cases that the government had brought, is an example of people who are beginning to see potential competition issues and they walk off the board. So I think where those issues occur, the antitrust laws are there to address them. You see sometimes on the corporate level where there are members who have a minority interest in a joint venture or a minority interest in a business that maybe could be considered competitive. And there'll be times, at least in my experience, where those directors or that director will be walled off from the flow of information, competitively sensitive information and the like. So I think the antitrust laws sort of apply to all those issues that you've identified where it raises an anti-competitive problem. Because I don't think the foregoing of an opportunity necessarily in every instance is anti-competitive. One other thing, you mentioned about mergers and the inability in certain circumstances for merger law to pick up or to be a remedy for this kind of issue because of thresholds. We are constantly reminded by our regulatory agencies here in the United States that just because your deal doesn't pass Hart-Scott thresholds doesn't mean they ain't coming after you substantively. So I think there are watchdogs out there even when you don't hit the merger thresholds. I'm just looking if I had anything else.
Well, you've stolen most of my points.
So those are, and I guess I want to echo Scott's point. I mean, that's good. I want to echo Scott's point. I mean, this really hit me as unique. It's something I hadn't thought of. I think about corporate opportunity and things like that, but I've never thought about antitrust as being the constraint or a possible remedy for that issue till I started reading this paper. But in any event, those are my comments.
John, do you have anything to add?
I'm sorry.
Well, between Scott and Helene, the true answer to that question is no. But I'm gonna try anyway.
But you're gonna talk anyway. Yeah.
So I have a very different perspective on these laws generally, and I think it's something that might be addressed in the paper, which is that from my perspective, these laws enhance competition. They enhance competition for the same way we see in exclusive dealing cases where dedication and loyalty leads to greater output and is therefore an efficiency that would otherwise justify a foreclosing an exclusive dealing arrangement. And here we see the same thing. If you don't want the directors or the senior managers of your company spending half their time worrying about how they're going to compete with you, you want them dedicating their efforts to the institution to make the institution more effective. So I think addressing the pro-competitive aspects of corporate opportunity laws is really something that is necessary to complete the paper. Second, at least from a U.S. perspective, this has what we call a copper weld problem. That in U.S. law, a corporation cannot conspire with its directors. Now, where this leads us to is, potentially a dominance problem. But again, there you would have to weigh the anti-competitive effects in a dominance case against the pro-competitive effects that we were just talking about. And then finally, I thought Scott's point on enhancing the discussion of covenants not to compete, it would be quite important here. The origins of English-American antitrust law go back to the Dyer's case, which was a 1415 covenant not to compete case. I think that's an area where, at least here, you don't have the same sort of copper weld problem, because in contracting independently with an employee or an officer, they are dealing with the company as a separate entity in that context. And we have seen cases, extremely rare, where broad covenants not to compete over a whole range of employees really do have a tendency to restrict competition. I think the analogy here to opportunity law is a good one and worth developing further. But Having said that, it was a great paper, gave all of us something to think about that really had not been on our radar screen, and I think it can be improved, but it's really thought-provoking. Thank you.
Okay. Since we're running a little short on time, let's move on to the third paper, if Rory wants to come up.
I got one original thought in.
Okay, so our tax system transfers trillions of dollars each year. Consumer spending also transfers trillions of dollars annually. But unlike taxes, the laws governing consumer transactions are not viewed as policy instruments for distributional goals. And I examine this kind of default assumption that consumer law is irrelevant through a series of three sub-questions that I'll take in turn. So the first is, what's the size of the pot? By how much might better consumer laws reduce the prices that people pay closer to the competitive level? Second, in what direction would that redistribute income? And third, how does consumer law compare to tax from an institutional perspective for distributional goals? So for this first question, the size of the pot, that's really a macroeconomic question. But in order to answer it, I had to track down hundreds of microeconomic studies of particular markets, telecommunications, credit cards, food, and also studies that are in different areas, so consumer protection related to behavioral economics and choice. Concentration, how does price change as industries become more concentrated? Licensing, occupational licensing. One study by Goldman Sachs, for instance, estimates that people pay on average 9% more for automobiles because of laws in all 50 states that essentially give monopolies to a given auto dealer, saying that that auto dealer is the only one that can sell a given manufacturer's cars in that territory, such as Ford's. So it tracked down these studies, kind of filtered out the less rigorous ones. There, as people in this room are probably pretty well aware, estimating precisely what the competitive level of pricing is or competitive dynamics in general with respect to pricing is somewhat of an imprecise undertaking. So I attempted to apply these studies conservatively, taking the lower bounds. And I constructed two scenarios, one more conservative scenario-based scenario here that leaves out a lot of, these all really leave out a lot of potential sources of overcharge, as I'm calling it. And then another scenario in which if you were to apply the literature, the best of the empirical literature, more directly, if you were to take it more seriously, what would that amount to? In the base scenario, this would amount to about 1.2 trillion, and in the more kind of direct application scenario, scenario two, it's about 1.8 trillion. So to put this number in perspective. And to be clear, this is not like, I'm not standing up here saying this is the number for overcharge. These are meant to, the real question here is if we were to try to have an empirically informed perspective on this number, what would it look like? And one of the reasons I wanted to do that is because the whole reason we're now thinking a lot as scholars about inequality, economic inequality, is because you know, if you go back 10 years, economists weren't really studying. This is really like a forgotten or backwater kind of topic. Now that you go to conferences, there's tons of the leading economists and others who are looking at this question. And the reason is that Thomas Piketty and Emmanuel Saez a few years back kind of found that through looking in a very detailed tax records, that the share of income earned by the top 1% had risen from 1980, that group earning 10% of all income, to by 2010, the top 1% earning 20% of all income. So it doubled. And this kind of caught everybody's attention and said, whoa, you know, caused people to say, well, there's something really important and concerning here. So that difference between 10% and 20% that kind of captured everybody's imagination on this topic is about $1.25 trillion. And so one of the reasons I wanted to look at how much is to ask, is it of a magnitude that might be relevant to these issues? And the short answer is yes. If you believe that economics, the best of economics, can tell us something about the magnitude. Now in terms of how, if we were to reduce some of this overcharge, how would that redistribute wealth, income? I'm gonna focus on actually just the income earned, although I go into other topics in the paper. The key input here in figuring out where this would go is figuring out how much of it would be captured once it enters a business by workers in the top 1%, senior employees, versus other employees, versus the owners. And this hasn't been directly studied with any rigor. People just don't have the data necessarily to do so. But there's some economic theory. There's indirect empirics that are relevant. So, for example, we know who owns businesses across the United States, which income group they fall into. And if you believe the corporate governance literature, the senior executives have a lot of power to direct resources internally. And there have been a couple of on-point studies about the effects of labor unions and how that influences the income earned by different groups. And all of that suggests that lower level employees probably are not successful in capturing much rents, many rents in terms of this overcharge, but senior employees and owners probably both do. If I had my basic sense is that senior executives probably are going to capture more than owners overall, but I start off with, again, I construct a couple scenarios. I start off in the base scenario, assuming that about 10% goes to lower level employees, again, trying to be conservative, and that the rest is split evenly between senior executives and owners. And under these assumptions, keeping with I round down to 1.1 trillion in the base scenario, assuming 45% is captured by senior managers, 10% by lower level employees, and then another 45% by owners. And then just kind of adjusting, if you were to wave a magic wand and reduce all of that overcharge, which, you know, we don't have, but for the sake of getting a sense of what's at stake here, that would reduce the share of income earned by the top 1% to 15%, so down from the 20% level that we talked about earlier, right? So in this and second scenario, using the more direct application of the empirical literature on overcharge, 1.7 trillion, if you assume that senior managers capture 75% of that for their income. And again, if you were to remove all overcharge, the share of income earned by the top 1% would be reduced down to 10%. Now, these numbers may or may not persuade anybody that something should be done, right? Because there's all kinds of, how do we get to this reduction of overcharge and so on. But I'll just say that these numbers also still leave out a lot of industries that we just don't have data on. There aren't really any good studies about internet and cable, for example. I mean, there's some that compare prices here to Canada and Europe, but just there's so many problems with that. This leaves out wealth effects, so we earn money this year to buy assets that then in future years kind of bring additional income. So there'd be more of an effect by reducing overcharge on inequality if you were to factor that in. Medicaid and Medicare left out. That's why I see this as kind of potentially a middle scenario in some respects. But this raises the question of, if you believe that reducing overcharge would have a huge impact on income inequality, what about the institutional trade-off? Um, So how do we compare tax law to consumer law? And on that, there are definitely some advantages for tax law. Informational advantages, for one. So I think we could probably predict with greater accuracy the actual distribution that will result from taxes than from consumer law in advance. Although I don't want to overstate that, because the CBO and other groups' estimates of the distribution of tax plans in advance is notoriously imprecise. Another benefit to tax is potentially just execution, right? So do we trust regulators to not block beneficial mergers, to get the consumer disclosure laws right, to not put up the wrong signs for gas on the side of the highway. And so there are execution challenges. Of course, tax itself has well-known disadvantages and drawbacks, such as the potential for fraud, widespread fraud, and loopholes that are unintentional. So definitely informational and execution potential advantages to consumer law, but I don't want to overstate them. One criterion, at least, though, would favor consumer law from an institutional perspective, and that's the criterion that at least scholars have emphasized above all others for choosing how the law should reduce inequality or achieve distributional goals, and that's inefficiency or efficiency concerns. So this comes from Kaplan and Chevelle. So ideally, we would choose the mechanism that would be most efficient. Tax laws, even when designed well, by nature, distort markets, right? Consumer laws, if designed well, would reduce market distortions, would make markets more competitive. And so that's one big reason why we might prefer consumer law. And so more than anything else, I would like to see this choice between consumer law and tax law move from kind of an intuitive dismissal to empirically informed. And I think that doing so could bring a great benefit and also could suggest that consumer law should be chosen for at least some portion of distribution. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Danny.
Like Larry, I don't need a microphone. In fact, there's a sign in front of my office that says, the door's closed, but I'm in. I'm a loud talker. So I think that the paper's really fascinating. It's very creative in drawing together things in a new way. So on the substitutability between tax and broadly termed consumer law, which in the paper really encompasses both antitrust law and consumer protection law, I think the kind of linkages that Rory's making are new, and I think really in the last month we've learned from an administrability side that making changes in the tax code is not so easy.
It's easy, it's just screwed up.
Okay, fair enough. So perhaps it allows us to rethink Kaplow and Chevelle, but it also allows us to go back to the other question, which we've been dealing with in a broader sense of, is competition the right tool? I say competition rather than antitrust, because I think the consumer protection side of that argument hasn't really been part of the broader agenda, and I think that's important. Now, the other thing that I think Rory does that's very helpful, though he doesn't call it this, he essentially has done a meta-analysis. And in a traditional meta-analysis, number one, I'd say, do us a favor, please, in an appendix, list all the studies that you look at. But that based on what I have found from the footnotes, it looks like in some ways you may undercount dramatically in certain industries because there is not reference to empirical literature in supply chain management, where you're going to have certain industries, and also in marketing, where again you're going to have industries both on the IO marketing side, and then actually on, because you talk quite a bit about the behavioral economics, on the psych marketing side as well. I think that would be very, very helpful. So the other thing is, since we're combining consumer protection and antitrust law within a broader vision of consumer law, something which Tim Uris once called as complementary peanut butter and jelly work so well together. I'm not joking, he really said that, and I think it's actually helpful. It turns out that overcharges mean different things for each of these different disciplines, and I'd say even within antitrust, overcharge means different things. So, for example, typically collusion overcharge is bad, but say for civil conduct, overcharge is good, and in fact in Trinco, the Supreme Court says, not only, you know, is it not bad, this is the whole reason why businesses exist, because they want to have more money, and then we're going to see different quote-unquote overcharges, which are going to be industry-specific. So we're going to see, back to George's point about why his computer is so expensive, we're going to see in certain industries, consumer, like consumer phones, pharma, etc., much more than we're going to see in very low-margin industries. Now, that's not necessarily a competition problem. That's just dynamics of the market. Now, I'd say, hold on yet another second, because if there's a distributional asset, from a distributional perspective, wouldn't we actually like to see more cartels ripping off the ultra-wealthy? And so we would want to see lack of enforcement of cartel laws. And so there's something that is missing in the paper I really want to push you on, which is, what are the policy implications? If you're right, there are important policy implications. And by the way, even if you're not right, there are important policy implications. So, right, is it more antitrust enforcement? Is it more what I call competition advocacy slash regulatory impact assessment, which, by the way, is only 1% of the FTC's budget, the fabulous trade commission. Or is it more consumer protection enforcement? Where do we put, shall we say, in an investment portfolio, where are we actually putting our investment dollars? How many resources? Sometimes we even signal certain industries that we like to focus on because the particular distributional effects are much larger. And merely by signaling, that chills certain behavior that might have those anti-competitive overcharge. So here it's not the overcharge, it's whether or not we have an anti-competitive overcharge that somehow is harming our consumers. Then there's the other issue, large cases, small cases. Do we bring test cases because we're looking to shape law long term, or we bring in the large cases? We've had some bad experiences, particularly under the Mike Perchuk era of the FTC, bringing horrifically bad cases. Before his era, we had horrifically bad lots of small Robinson-Patman cases. But then under Perchuk, we said, no, let's stop bringing bad small cases. Let's bring small, rather large bad cases. That didn't go so well. Then we're also assuming that these are our only institutions. What about our sector regulators that have some of these other missions as well, that broader competition within a broader public interest framework, private enforcement, our state enforcers, of which we have two who were on the panel, one who worked for one of the people on the panel. So all of us in the audience are dealing with some of these issues. And then finally, I'd say to a certain extent, where I want you to focus, perhaps in the paper, if what we're concerned about is income inequality, think through, it's not merely antitrust, consumer protection broadly versus tax. Every time, as Harry said earlier, we're thinking about some of these issues, there are other kinds of reactions that happen as a result of it. So one of it actually, and it's not something you raise in the paper, but to a certain extent, tax ultimately gets decided by Congress, and there's a certain amount more of democratic legitimacy or illegitimacy, depending on your viewpoint there, than if it's done by administrative agencies. And I know it goes outside the broader efficiency framework that you have, but it's something to consider, because I think that's where some of the populist swell comes from. We need to have new laws because we're upset. And courts react to it. There's a reason why in a lot of antitrust doctrines, we don't overturn doctrine. Rather, we limit it so much, in part because we don't want the legislative backlash. So there are very complex institutional pieces that you move something here and then all of a sudden we see it over there. And that's something just to map out, I think, ultimately in a separate follow-up article of how do you implement this kind of process. But I want you thinking about that. And then one other final point, only because I see Harry, I love Harry, and I want to talk about Harry's work. And so Harry says, so the traditional issue that we have is, guess what? We actually don't have excessive pricing as part of our antitrust laws. We couldn't care less about high prices. Henry has a paper that says, hold on a second. Actually, there's a lot, even within traditional antitrust, that suggests not using the word excessive pricing, as we have, say, in Europe, but taking existing antitrust law. Actually, that's a lot of what our antitrust cases are ultimately really about. But we're just sort of, with a sleight of hand, calling it one thing, but really that's what it's after. So I'd also push you on that side. Thank you.
Okay.
Your paper really was very thought-provoking, and I just don't want to pile on to the comments, and I won't repeat the comments that that Danny had made. But your paper starts from the premise how you define overcharge, and it's basically an overcharge is greater than marginal cost, so it's an inefficient price. Not necessarily is every inefficient price anti-competitive or causing consumer harm. And in particular, you define three different ways of looking at overcharges, or three buckets of looking at overcharges. And the one I think that raises more issues for me in thinking about it, because it's more difficult, maybe, is the behavioral bucket, which really comprises, I guess, information asymmetries and what I'm taking advantage of consumer behavior. Let me start with the information asymmetries, because again, I'm not sure that all of those asymmetries are legal, and what that remedy is, which is usually more transparency. I think going back to the last panel, to the crowd that was here, we listened to an example with pricing of gas stations, and that's another example, where if you post all those prices along with the octane posting that the FTC required, if you post all those prices in a neighborhood or in a geographic market, you're gonna see, not surprisingly, price uniformity. So I'm not even sure if information asymmetry, how you deal with that, and if the remedy isn't worse than the remedy is worse than the problem, I don't even know how to say it, but that it's that kind of issue, and who pays for that? And ultimately, we always know it's the other guy, which is the consumer who also pays. The other issue that taking advantage of consumers with complicated pricing or two-level pricing or the razor blade sort of issue that we talk about, I mean, that also harks back to the top two. Perchak and thinking about vulnerable groups under Section 5, when you think about consumer protection law, we think about defining who are we trying to protect, you know, whose perspective, and then we go from the vulnerable groups to ultimately the reasonable person standard under Section 5 in consumer protection. And that again raises an issue of who are we protecting, is it illegal? The antitrust overcharge, however, I think is an area that's interesting. I think there's more consensus, clearly in cartel cases, you know, estimating that is probably easier to get consensus on that those kinds of overcharges are illegal. You also put in that same bucket market power, increasing of price as a result of mergers. And go to various industries where, for whatever reason, the government didn't stop those mergers and private parties didn't stop those mergers. That may be more difficult in thinking about, because in your next step, you take these numbers, this amount of overcharge, and you apply it to categories of expenditures by people. And that, again, I think that methodologically, actually is a problem in that you're taking behavior numbers that came from behaviors of some firms and necessarily spreading it to the whole industry. A cartel case, again, I keep going back to that because that may be an easier way of extrapolating from that, because if you're assuming in a cartel case you have a number of companies behaving, and whether you're in the cartel or because the cartel sets up an umbrella and affects the pricing of the other guys, that maybe extrapolating to that entire industry or category as you're doing. makes more methodological sense. What else? Your point, which is at the end of your paper, and you made it again today, consumer law, if properly done, is the most, since at its core, it's trying to eliminate market inefficiencies and enable markets to operate in its most efficient way. I mean, I may not be happy with what the market looks like, but at least everyone's got a shot and wants to be in market, whatever. It is very important, and I think it is very interesting. I mean, a lot of times we see the tension between consumer protection and antitrust, that in going too far in consumer protection, the regulatory agency, whether it's on the federal or state level or city level, is resulting in a remedy that really adversely affects competition in the marketplace or creates entry barriers, not dissimilar to your third category of tariffs and occupational issues of licensing and territorial restrictions. I think perhaps if you focus in on things like cartels, where there must be a lot of work, whether it's governmental or private, even trolling through those private litigations, treble damage cases, where people are putting in reports to estimate overcharge on some of those things. You may be able to get just a narrow idea of doing some empirical work that proves your point on a smaller scale and then extrapolate.
John?
So we're running late on time, so I'll be very brief. But I have a question for the audience. Who is not an aspiring one percenter? Thought so.
No. University professors.
But by their conduct.
Well, yeah. Other than the ones that make a fortune consulting, but okay. So the only comments I have.
I don't know who you have in mind.
The only comment I have in addition to Danny's and Helene's that I thought were well put is I think the paper would benefit by a little more rigor underneath the assumptions, particularly, there's a baked in assumption that concentration leads to higher prices. I mean, that's been under attack for, 40 years. And, so either change the focus away from concentration and look at actual merger effects, which I know you try to do in the paper, would be helpful. And second, the assumption, going back to the one percenters, that they are the beneficiaries of overcharge requires, I think, a little more rigor. Intuitively, it seems right, but I'd like to see some data to back it up. And I think the Congress would, because, the Klobuchar bill is really directed at that, and those data would be very interesting. But, excellent paper, very enjoyable.
Okay, thank you. So our next presenter is John Newman.
In the unenviable position of standing between you all and lunch. So we'll try to move fairly quickly, maybe have a little bit of fun along the way. The topic today is pro-competitive justifications, and that's one that I think is pretty familiar to a lot of us. So this is an attempt to take a fresh look at a familiar topic. The focus is on section one in the paper, although, as we know, the rule of reason's mode of analysis, the burden-shifting framework, tends to dominate most of civil antitrust today. So my gut, my intuition, in the sense that really gave rise to this paper, is that defendants have been getting increasingly creative with the types of pro-competitive justifications that they've been offering over, say, the last 20 or 30 years. So just a flavor, and a lot of these will probably look familiar. We saw an argument around creating a healthier market for e-books. We see the NCAA's arguments. Really interesting case involving horse welfare that I located. another one involving new trucks. Actually, it was new paint jobs for trucks and new uniforms for delivery people. We needed to get around harmful government regulations, increase access to Ivy League education, NFL team owner loyalty. Great one. We need to fund repair efforts for grave sites that settler shift over time. And my personal favorite pair, a defendant arguing that it needed to protect a group of its customers from having to subsidize another group. And then a different defendant arguing, we had to force one of our groups of customers to subsidize another group. So the exact opposite. When you see defendants making arguments like this, I think that suggests the law must be fairly unsettled. And in fact, if you crack open the venerable Sullivan Horn book, that's exactly what we see. So this is literally just an open question. This core part of the dominant mode of antitrust analysis in the civil realm seems to be kind of an open question. And that's really the question presented that the paper takes up, is which of these justifications are valid? And because I'm trained as an attorney rather than an economist, I can't resist the prescriptive question of which ones should be valid. So we'll undertake that one as well. But the framework the paper uses to get at those two questions is to first identify what I see as the leading approaches, then undertake a sort of descriptive analysis, which one do courts seem to be using, and then to undertake a normative analysis using the error cost framework, which one of these is better or optimal, and then finally conclude with some prescriptive recommendations. So first, what are the leading approaches that we see in the case law? I see three. The first one I call the competitive process approach, and that's basically what it sounds like. So you ask, if a defendant's restraint of trade harms the competitive process or competition, whatever that might be, we'll then ask, oh, does it also benefit the competitive process somehow? If so, maybe it's justified. The second I call the market failure approach, and that draws on a fairly well-established body of neo-Chicagoan economics to ask whether the defendant's restraint in a partial equilibrium analysis causes the relevant market to somehow increase welfare. And in the antitrust world, it's generally well settled that that means consumer welfare or consumer surplus. Then finally, we see the type of effect approach I call, and that's kind of a shortcut or a heuristic approach as I understand it. It's an attempt to get at that market failure analysis in a more shorthand way. So we'll just ask, oh, does the defendant's conduct do something that's on our pre-approved checklist? If so, it's fine. Well, if you take a look at case law, I think you generally see an early support for the market failure approach. In CBOT, Chicago Board of Trade, 1918, we see Justice Brandeis talking about things like helping to improve the conditions of the market as a good argument. That suggests to me a kind of market failure approach, obviously an early one, so the lingo changes over time. And then we don't see the court doing too much of interest for about 40 years. We then see the, what I would call the competitive process era, what others have called the inhospitality era of antitrust. During this time, the court is very much concerned with the competitive process and competition, and also very unfriendly to antitrust defendants. Well, then 1977, the so-called modern era of antitrust is launched. GTE Sylvania, we see courts in a pretty unbroken string, maybe setting aside National Society of Professional Engineers, talking about market failures as the means of doing pro-competitive justification analysis. Well, just a flavor of what that looks like in action. We're all probably pretty familiar with this passage from Topco. The court, and I love this rhetoric, by the way, but the court talks about the freedom to compete. So it's trying to define what competition is. And it says that's the freedom guaranteed to each and every business, and you can read it, the freedom to assert with vigor whatever economic muscle you can muster. And that all sounds really, really good, I think. But to a given court trying to decide whether a given offered pro-competitive justification is valid or not, what does that mean? Not abundantly clear. What we do see, though, the ramification of that, is that defendants can certainly not argue that competition wasn't working, so we needed to step in. If competition is the goal and means and end of antitrust, of course a defendant can't argue competition was broken. And that's, I think, how we end up seeing these per se illegality rules develop. To me, it's less about the goal of antitrust and more about what kinds of arguments we're going to allow defendants to make. Compare and contrast that with 1977 GTE Sylvania, the court's explicitly talking about market failures, right? Market imperfections. The free rider effect, controversial as it may be, has a relatively clear meaning. We understand some of the conditions that have to hold for it to occur. And we see that defendants certainly can argue that competition wasn't working, so they needed to step in and make it work better. So much different outcomes, right? We start backing off of those per se illegality rules. And again, what's driving it seems to be not the goals of antitrust writ large, so much as it is what kinds of arguments we're going to let defendants make. All right, so I pause here in the paper to take a quick dive, or maybe a sidetrack, into some normative implications of that. So there are a set of cases that involve what I would call non-welfare justifications. And these are often called non-economic justifications. The best one I can use is the horse case, right? Everyone would agree that horse welfare is not consumer welfare. So the argument around creating horse welfare or promoting it shouldn't be a good argument under the antitrust laws as they're currently constituted. That's not to say a court couldn't dismiss a case like that at the outset, calling it just non-commercial conduct in general. And that is like what the court did in the Missouri v. National Organization of Women case, right, the Eighth Circuit. That's fine. But at the second to last stage of a rule of reason analysis, considering this kind of non-welfare justification introduces all kinds of commensurability problems, I think. How do you weigh horses' health against higher ticket prices to a horse show competition? That's just, it's almost laughable, right? All right, so that's the descriptive analysis with a little bit of a normative argument baked into it. What about an error cost analysis? Which of these three approaches that I see courts using minimizes the cost of error? First off, the competitive process approach. I've never seen, and that doesn't mean it doesn't exist, but I've never seen a really good definition of what competition is. Now, what is the competitive process? If there is no good definition, then courts are left with very little guidance and we'll just see them all over the place, vis-a-vis the goal of antitrust. Alternatively, maybe competition means a state of atomistic rivalry, right? With a lot of buyers and a lot of sellers, all interacting in these simple one-off spot contracting type situations. If so, then we're going to condemn everything that doesn't look like that. Lo and behold, that's kind of what we saw during the competitive process era. Even the most progressive antitrust person, I think, would agree that Topco can't be what antitrust is about. Right? I mean, condemning a bunch of tiny grocery stores who are trying to offer a private label, that can't be what antitrust is about. I think we'd all agree on that. But maybe not. Maybe not. On the other hand, the market failure approach seems to get at what at least the consensus goal of antitrust is, consumer welfare, and it offers relatively clear guidance, at least vis-a-vis the competitive process approach. What about this type of effect approach? So let's say the market failure approach is correct and good. Can we use the type of effect heuristic as a way to get at that market failure analysis in a cheaper, quicker way? Maybe if something creates higher output, it's always good, or at least close enough that we can use that as a heuristic. The problem is, what happens when you run into a new type of effect that's not on the pre-approved list? Right? This approach has nothing to say. So for instance, the case involving an argument about new paint jobs for a delivery truck, the court, in my reading, had basically no idea what to do with that. That's not on our good list, that's not on our bad list, that's just a new argument. So we have no guidance again. We're all over the place. What happens when the list is wrong? So I would agree, and I thank John for pointing this out earlier, antitrust is about more than output. Higher output is not always good, right? So there are a lot of different types of conduct, lying, right, for one, that can increase output and yet not be good under any definition of the antitrust laws or consumer laws writ large. Another one might be, more controversially, irrational overconsumption, right? So if you have a restraint of trade that lowers irrational overconsumption, that might be good for consumers, nonetheless, it would lower output. So this list, I think, is wrong sometimes, and it's going to create consistent but inaccurate results. Finally, I read some type of effect cases as courts crediting justifications that are really just shams. So you see a defendant paying lip service to the types of effects that have been recognized as good in the past. Oh, we're trying to fix free riding. And courts, I think, because they're doing a kind of shortcut to start with, are suckered into believing those sham justifications when there's really nothing there. So I see problems using this shortcut. Finally, the paper concludes with some prescriptive recommendations. So let's assume the market failure approach is good and right, and we shouldn't use type of effect as a shortcut to get at it. Can we make it even better? I think so. And this is really not a super complex argument. It's just expanding out the basic question into three sub-questions. I think courts should walk through and enforcers should walk through in every case. So first off, identify the specific alleged market failure that a defendant is offering. Is that something that's even in the realm of theory? This is kind of a theoretical question, something that is creditable as a market failure. Second, now this is a factual question, did the unrestrained market actually fail, absent the restraint? Third, another fact question, does the restraint actually alleviate that failure? Can this actually improve court's decision making would be my next question. I think so. So I conclude with a case illustration, and I'll offer the quick caveat that I was part of the trial team on the Amex case. These are my views, not those of the Justice Department, of course. And I'm drawing only on the reported opinion itself, no confidential information. In the Amex case, the trial court decision, Amex first had to identify a specific alleged market failure. And the one it came up with was free riding. We're offering some data analytics to merchants, and other merchants are free riding on those somehow. Well, the court said, okay, that's good. That's in theory a good argument. But did the market actually suffer that failure? As it turns out, Amex is able to charge some of its merchants for these data analytics. And where you can charge for something, there is no free ride. So the argument falls apart, unhappy defendant. Tipping my hand just a little bit, the underlying normative goal of this paper here, it's a bit of a Trojan horse. So it speaks very much in the lingo and uses the framework of sort of neo-Chicagoan law and economics. But it does so with the normative goal, the underlying normative goal of strengthening antitrust law. So that's what's floating under the surface here. But with that, I'd like to hear what you all think.
Great. Harry?
Let's start this. Oh, that starts. Okay. So before I defend Topco.
Good luck with that.
Hey, I'm right. Okay. Before I defend Topco, so generally, this is a very thought-provoking paper because it got me to ask some very basic definitional questions about the terms you're using. It's also important, obviously, I shouldn't say obviously, but it is important because it goes to one of the major dilemmas that we have in antitrust, which is what justifications are cognizable in defense and what are not. So interestingly enough, we often think of the per se rule of reason argument in different ways. So maybe it's a rule of legality, per se illegal. Maybe it's a rule about shifting burdens of proof. But it's also a rule about defenses. So what defenses do we allow? What justifications? So you're taking on an important issue. And we lawyers, actually, I think it's true of economists too, love categories. So if we can put things into categories and say, it falls in that category, and we can name it, we feel better. But not only do we feel better, it is useful for making decisions. So it's useful for counseling, and it's useful for judges in deciding cases. So we do put a lot of effort into categories, and you've given us one. It's called market failure. So the question with any category, so lots of questions with it, but one is, what's the definition? The second is, how is it helpful? Why is that a good category? And then the third is, which is sort of connected to both, is it useful? So here was the thought-provoking part. What is market failure? Now, I tend to do research with the books that are in my office. I don't go any further. So it's an efficient way of doing things. And I pulled out various economics textbooks. I thought, I'll look at Fred Kahn's book on regulation, because why do we have regulation? Because of market failure. You know, we have markets are monopolized. We need to do something about it. I combed the index. He never uses the term. And I started looking elsewhere. And trying to think about it. And actually, of course, the good place to look is in your paper. How does the author define market failure? And the courts actually don't use it. So, of course, you're good to quote from Sylvania, but they call it a market imperfection. So what are we meaning by this category? Market failure occurs when a market produces outcomes that are less efficient than they might be. Well, okay. You know, we're not doing as well as we can. And what's an efficient outcome? One that maximizes consumer welfare, for John, not producer welfare, not. And restraints are justified if they maximize, or I assume improve, consumer welfare. Now, in that sense, I don't want to say, well, this is very unobjectionable. I mean, that sounds like what we think we're doing. And so then the question is, well, if that's what we're doing, why use the words? Why not just say, let's look for things that maximize consumer welfare or improve it? If the restraint improves it, we're fine. And if market failure doesn't convey particular things, we need to ask, well, what are examples of market failure? So let's do away with the label and let's just use the examples, unless the label helps us generalize, which I'm not sure it does. So we've got free riding externalities, maybe consumer irrationality, maybe transactions costs. You've got a few of them running around in the paper. So fine. So if even if this is a label we're going to use, how does it help us in a way? And one of the things is, which you said at the end, you want to keep away. Defendants are very creative. Believe me, with this label, they'll still be creative. Because defense counsel is paid a lot and hire economists, and we can think of lots of things we're going to call market failures. This won't stop it. But we want to stay away from, focus on expanding output and price. I'm not sure you mean that low price is something we want to stay away from. But expanding output you call an unhealthy obsession. Cool. Okay, so that's over to you, John, which you mentioned it earlier. I'm not sure. You know, there are times when expanding output's good, and there are times when maybe it's not. How will it help us? So this connects to the third point, which is how do we use it? You know, does it either explain and better, will it help us decide cases? So this actually is where I do have the problem with the label, because since it's not self-explanatory. It's like good labels like consumer welfare. What does that mean? It means what we wanted to say. So Barack Orbach has written 1,000 papers on how difficult it is to figure out what people mean when they mean consumer welfare. So what do you mean by market failure? So I think the first thing I think of is, well, when markets really fail. So I think of, I'll give you four of them. Appalachian Coals, Superior Court Trial Lawyers Association, three of them, and engineers. All right, these were cases in which, so Appalachian Coals, the coal, oh my God, it's coal again. Because of the Depression, there was excess capacity. Coal industry was failing in Appalachia. They got together to restrict output and market it jointly. There's some transactional efficiencies, but you know, basically, it's an output cartel because the markets were failing. You don't want to consider that. I know. But market failure. Superior Court Trial Lawyers Association, principal agent problem. The DC government has no interest in making sure that indigent defendants get good defense get good defense lawyers. The defense lawyers say, pay us a little bit more and we'll actually spend some time on these cases. They'll get a better defense. The market is failing. The competition among lawyers is producing bad lawyering. We can give it better if we can collude on price. I assume you don't want to include that. Engineers, of course, is the one where if we compete on engineering services before we put in our bid, you'll get very low, very cheap engineering. And guess what? 20 years, that bridge is going to come down. So we have an intertemporal market failure. So all of those things, court didn't want to consider that. Not quite sure where you feel about engineers, but presumably the other two I know. So finally, Topco. Now, I did notice that you put it in the dustbin of history. And the inhospitality tradition, which you write about in your paper, I hope you will balance with the hospitality tradition, where now the court has never met a restraint it doesn't like. So, but rhetoric aside, part of the question in Topco is, so if we took a market failure approach, would that prevent errors? Would it, you know, be good on error costs? And is that the right approach? So actually, the real question in Topco, which was not fully explored at trial, was whether there really were free rider issues or whether this was a cartel of medium-sized supermarket chains that were trying to keep each other out of their markets. There's a lot of evidence, frankly, for the latter. The evidence on free riding is actually sort of weak, and the court knew it was weak because in oral argument, they said, well, why can't you just put a different label on the cans? The whole thing was about private labels. So don't call your private label product Topco, call it Bottomco. Then you can have two competing chains in the same market. Defense counsel had no answer for that because there was no answer for that. And in fact, Topco had considered what the costs would be of, which were not huge, of having a second label. So that was never fully worked out at trial because of the way Don Turner wanted to try the case. He wanted to try it. It took 6 days to try Topco. What a great world that was, except for trial lawyers. And there were no economists testifying. What a world. But if it's an error cost issue, as you point out, if you yell free rider and that's market failure, you can still make mistakes because courts can be bamboozled. And in some sense, because of the truncated record, the trial judge was bamboozled. This really was, I will say it, a cartel case, division of markets. Even if you don't like per se, it was sort of a BMI analysis before BMI came along. So we're now out of time. I'm the one between you and lunch. Right, so we're out of time, but anyway, I have other things, and I know the commentators do, so that's it.
Okay, so I think I'm next, but I'll make my comments pretty brief, and I'll agree with Harry. The first thing I wrote down when I was reading this paper is, where did this term market failure come from? And I went to Westlaw, and I didn't locate it in any case law, so the term failure indicates something pretty ominous. I look at failing firms from the merger guidelines. So, setting that aside, I had the sort of same reaction about the terminology. But what I do really, like about this paper is that it applies a more rigorous approach to pro-competitive justifications. It actually requires, I think, the defendants to meet a burden, which is sometimes lacking. You can just, instead of calling it market failure, you can call it something else. But fundamentally, I think your approach forces a defendant to identify a problem, and then does the actual pro-competitive justification remedy that problem? And, it reminds me of Section 10 of the merger guidelines on efficiencies, because you have to, under Section 10, actually identify verifiable and non-speculative efficiencies that are quantifiable. And so in your methodology, I feel like because you're unpacking this analysis into these various steps, it does provide more rigor to the actual burden that has to be met. And so I think that's sort of my main takeaway from the paper, which I think is gonna be, it's a very effective at doing that, and I think it would be, from a plaintiff's perspective or an enforcer's perspective, to really hold the defendant's feet to the fire on some of these pro-competitive justifications that they just sort of throw out there. They're more heuristic, like free riding. So I really appreciated the paper from that perspective. I had the same reaction as Harry to these statements about output that you have in the paper, about the notion that higher output in some instances reduces consumer welfare. And so I really just wanted examples of that. And you know, you had pointed to, I guess there's a case or an environmental pollution, which you identified as an externality that could cause market failure. But I just want to know, like, you know, I'm very, I guess, focused on output, you know, myself. But so what are the instances where higher output reduces consumer welfare? I just want, I need some examples. And then I did actually appreciate the citation to Stephen King. So now Gunslinger is on my Kindle. But anyway, it's a very, very good paper, and thank you very much.
Well, I'm really the one between you and lunch, so I'll be as quick as I can. So this is an incredibly important paper and an incredibly important topic, and I really thank you for writing it. I do think some improvements are warranted. Specifically, I think a major question that both Harry and Gwendolyn identified is just, let's not make this about semantics, because a lot of it is, and we need to be precise, and I think the way it was just put is the right way. Is there a competitive problem? Does this fix it? And that, I think, is a good way of doing it. Whether we call it market imperfections or not is less important. I do think it's not really right to say that Sylvania okayed the argument that competition is bad. Sylvania said that you'll have more competition if you're allowed to limit one type, intra-brand competition, for the benefit of inter-brand competition. And I'm confident they didn't think that competition being bad could be a defense, because they said exactly the opposite 1 year later in the engineers' case. And so I'd encourage you to look at that. And then going back to the concept of competitive process, I don't view competitive process as part of the inhospitality era, and I would encourage you to look at that further. There's an excellent article by Greg Worden on competitive process really being the appropriate standard for antitrust law that I would commend to you. And there's sort of a codicil to that I wrote in the antitrust source about a year and a half ago, saying, yes, competitive process should be the standard, but let's make it more precise by focusing on output. And really, the only case that I know of where more output is bad is predatory pricing. Because predatory pricing is overly flooding the market to increase output in the short run for the sake of reducing output in the long run. So I'd encourage you to look at that further, and I would encourage everyone to go out and get the nice lunch after.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.